scripture today continues our exploration of the stories and the storytellers revealing to us this movement from the wilderness into the promised land. From Joshua, they crossed the Jordan and they discover what lies before them. Part of the story comes to us in Joshua chapter 6. I'll read the words in yellow print, invite you to read that together in white. On the seventh day, they got up at daybreak and marched around the city seven times in the same manner, except that on that day, they circled the city seven times.
To the elite
extensive doctrines, creedal statements, all sharing what that particular manifestation of the church thought was the truth, sharing what they wanted everyone who was considered a faithful member to believe. We will agree on these things. And the list became extraordinary, and the creeds became volumes of books, not just a paragraph we could read together, but an extensive, elaborate explanation of what the truth is as we, whatever we are talking about, see it. It was the traditional, the right, the sacred way of being church. And throughout history, the church had a lot of creative ways of dealing with people who strayed from both the tradition and the truth as they saw it. Sometimes it was torture, sometimes it was burning on stakes, sometimes it was being kicked out of town or treated with contempt. They had a way of enforcing their belief that we should all agree because we are right. Then about 20 years or so into the life of a new nation on this continent, people on the frontier began to rebel. It wasn't the first time anyone rebelled against traditional religion, and it is one of the more significant times in which it actually stuck. In revivals, in small congregations, people on the frontier who were, by necessity, self-sufficient, by spirit independent, insisted that no one else should interpret the scripture to them, no one else should tell them what the truth is, no one should compel them to believe a specific doctrine. No one should impose upon them this insistence that we all agree. In Kentucky, they were called Christians. In Pennsylvania and West Virginia, they were called disciples. And in Lexington, Kentucky in 1832, representatives from both groups shook hands. And people in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ look back to that as a seminal moment in our movement. A movement that insisted on individual freedom, that claimed and cherished personal responsibility for faith. Now, I suppose anyone could have told them that where traditional religion, with its core beliefs and its enforcement of agreement, while it tended to bring a sense of order and peace, that this movement that would insist upon freedom would most certainly lead to disagreement, would most likely create chaos, and would probably eventually create division. If we don't all agree on the same things, then how can we possibly be united? Traditional religion had never succeeded. And yet through generations and generations and generations of challenge and conflict and division, a core group continued to maintain that same spirit and kept marching through time, insisting that there is no creed but Christ, no book but the Bible, and that unity is our polar star. We will be unified not because we all agree on everything, but because all agree that we will be one despite the things we disagree about. And accept this radical concept that our common faith in Jesus, as varied as it may be, that our common devotion to God, as different as it may appear, will be sufficient to keep us one. Through all the challenges that time brought, all the disagreements that created great pain and struggle. And one of the earliest of the divisions, somewhere in the mid-19th century, occurred when some believers began to apply a new way of looking at Scripture. Scripture was new to the common person, right? And some scholars were teaching some methods of trying to help people ask questions in order to understand the text, in order to determine what's the message in this text, what's important for us. And traditional religion did not like questions. Right? Here's the truth. It's your job to simply believe it. Don't ask questions. Don't wonder if there are internal conflicts. Don't wonder if this is still true today, or what meaning this might have, or why this doesn't seem to be related to our personal experience of life. Don't ask questions like that. We've made those decisions for you. The very fact that we ask questions about what we read in Scripture then becomes one of the defining characteristics of our movement. We believe in God, we have strong faith in God, and we think that faith can survive questions. While many traditions still discourage questioning, it has been part of our nature. Today's scripture is one of those stories of faith that might be brought into question. God has promised them a promised land. Said, go and receive it. Okay, thank you very much. Our people haven't been here in 400 years, and other people are already settled in these new lands, but okay, we'll take it back. And they'll march into it, and they'll fight the battles. They discover that the promised land was not given to them. And God is with them, and God promises to be faithful, and God seems to be instructing Joshua on how to lead the people, and Joshua becomes this very prominent, powerful leader. And they take on Jericho, the first big challenge that's coming into the promised land. And they have this scheme, and they have this method, and they're spreading terror within the walls of Jericho. And they are preparing to overwhelm it. The day comes, the walls collapse, and they charge into the city. Common siege tactics. It's the way people won battles. And then we get to that last verse that you all read. They went into the city. And apart from Rahab and the people of her household, they killed every man, every woman, every child, even their pets and their livestock. We can certainly see how that would serve the purpose. It's going to, well, honestly, I don't know who's going to tell the story about it because they killed all. But it's supposed to inflict terror upon their future enemies. It's supposed to help sustain what is becoming, and you'll see it emerging more and more in Scripture, this purposes. But the question, the God who 40 years earlier told them, "Thou shalt not kill," is pleased by the killing of children? I don't know if any of you are familiar with this. Let's put this picture up on the screen. This is an illustration of a study of a problem in ethics or moral philosophy. It's an illustration of what they call the trolley problem. And part of its effort is to try to help us decide, how do we know what is right? How do we make choices between right and wrong, particularly in complex situations? The trolley problem looks like this. There is a runaway trolley coming down the track, and it's set to go straight down the track. And if it does, it's going to run over five people. You are standing at the switch, and you see it unfolding before you. And if you move that switch, the trolley will switch tracks to the other and will only run over one person. What's the ethical choice? What's the right thing to do? It's an exercise in what's called utilitarian ethics. And there are some basic assumptions. The first one is that each individual is just as important as the next. So it doesn't matter who it is lying on the track. And utilitarian ethics says the right thing to do is the one that results in the least pain and the most happiness. It becomes, you know, what I tend to call utilitarian math. Flip the switch, one dies. Don't touch the switch, five dies. The math is very simple. Though, of course, some people say, you know what, if I don't do anything at all, then maybe I'm not responsible for any of it. And therefore, we have to question the ethics of people who stand by and watch disaster unfold right in front of them. Sometimes in life we are placed in a situation where we are forced to be responsible for decisions. The trolley problem is simple math. You throw the switch. Not rejoicing in it, but understanding that it's the lesser of two evils, shall we say. Now let's complicate this complex issue. This one person over on this track is someone you know and love very dearly. Closer than a brother, a spouse, a child of yours. The other five are strangers. What's the right thing to do? Utilitarian ethics says it's still one is still less than five, but on an individual basis, we tend to do the math differently. And we look at this as a higher cost because it's someone we love and it doesn't compare to those people. And we discover, at least in theory, the effects that bias have on our decisions when we're trying to make judgments about what's right and what's wrong. I think it's typical when we look at the story of Joshua, of what happened when Joshua fit the battle at Jericho, that we are looking at it from an extraordinarily biased point of view. It says here, they're God's people. We like God. We like God's people. We've chosen our team. We want to see them win. We want to see them progress. And while for most of us, most if some people we were not biased toward would go into a village and kill every man, woman, and child, most of the time we would say that's evil, that's wrong. But somehow, because we're on the side of the Israelites, we have this bias, and well, of course it must be okay. It's in the Bible, of course it must be okay. But I suppose even more challenging is the fact that this is hardly the last time that people who thought they were chosen marched into a new land and used these kinds of tactics. Europeans came across the notion to their promised land and discovered it. They discovered a land that, as it turns, was incredibly well populated by people who've been here 1,000 years, but Europeans discovered it. Europeans then civilized it. From Columbus and the conquistadors that spread through the central and western part of the continents, the English and French who came in from the east, and each time moving the natives away. Here, go here, get out of our way. Here, move here, get out of our way. And if they didn't, we would apply the Jericho method. If we annihilate the opposition, then the land is ours. History can't possibly estimate it, but they're talking about tens of millions of natives who died as a result of European conquest of this continent. But it must be okay, because we're on their side. Well, we're their descendants. We are benefiting from everything they did. We are grateful to have this land and thankful that it's turning out well. And I guess, well, that is just what had to happen. The bias perhaps shades our ethics, even to the point that we still celebrate Columbus Day. And if you knew what Columbus did to the natives and you cared about people, all people, it's not something you celebrate. Whether something happened a few centuries ago or a few millennia ago, the ethics is not always easy. And truly, we can't do a thing about what the Israelites did in Jericho, and we can't do a thing about what Europeans did when they entered this land. We can't do a thing about what our fathers and grandfathers did. Except, a lot of people are calling us to at least recognize the complexity and acknowledge the tragedy. At least admit that the ethics is sketchy. And maybe if we can start looking more objectively at the historical past, we'll maybe be able to develop a better idea of how to be ethical today, how to make decisions for ourselves, for our families, for our communities, for our nation. It's not a pleasant topic, but I think it is a hopeful one, because most of us today would not think to do what our ancestors did 200 years ago, Most of us would not stomach slavery on an institutionalized level the way it was 200 years ago. Most of us would not march into a native village and kill every man, woman, and child the way that people have been doing for centuries. Maybe we are progressing, maybe God is getting through, maybe love is starting to grow. Maybe when we say that we're all created equal, we're believing it a little bit more powerfully. Maybe when we say that God loves us all, we're believing it a little more assuredly. Maybe God is still at work amongst us. And as scriptures tell us, God promised Joshua, I will be with you, and I will walk with you, and I will teach you, and I will strengthen you, and I will encourage you. And all we really have to do is be willing to ask the questions and learn the lessons, and then put them to work. May God bless us as we seek to simply be the best people we can be, loving the world with the same spirit that came to us through Christ. Let us pray. We are thinking people, O God, and we ask questions and we make our decisions, and sometimes we discover that what we once thought is not what we think anymore. That's the gift you've given us, to be able to learn and to grow and to be more and more led by your Spirit and inspired by the love and grace you pour out upon us. We do not have all the answers, O God. We do not agree on the answers we have. But we are one because we are trying our best to love you and to pass your love on people around us. We are one because we believe that you love us. And we believe that's enough. So continue to love us and inspire us, O God, to help us think through our decisions, to help us stand for what we believe in, and to help us do what is true. In Jesus' name.